Hi everyone and welcome to Bodyworks Prime. Today we're going over the origin, insertion and action of the internal oblique muscle.
Here we can see the internal oblique muscle in isolation, excluding its aponeurosis. And next we can see pictured here the internal oblique's aponeurosis, which is a flat sheet-like tendinous structure connecting into the linea alba in the middle. The linea alba is a tendinous and fibrous line which runs down the midsection here. This line's made up of the aponeuroses of the internal oblique, the external oblique, and the transversus abdominis. Linea alba, translated from Latin to English, literally means white line due to its white line-like appearance. And the internal oblique is one of the five abdominal muscles. The other four are the external oblique, the rectus abdominis, the transversus abdominis, and the pyramidalis. If you want to learn more about any of those muscles, I'll put links to their respective videos in the description box below. In terms of the internal oblique's relation to those muscles, the internal oblique is located superficially to the transversus abdominis and deep to the external oblique. So essentially, it's located between those two muscles. So let's take a look at the origin next, and we'll start by looking at the anterior side, and you can see here the inguinal ligament. The inguinal ligament's a band of connective tissue, and it extends from the anterior superior iliac spine of the ilium here to the pubic tubercle of the pubic bone. And you can see this section of the inguinal ligament, which I've marked out in red. And this section is the origin of the internal oblique muscle. So the internal oblique is originating from the lateral two-thirds of the inguinal ligament. And next we can see a view where we're slightly looking down on the pelvic bone, and you can see our second point of origin highlighted in red, and that's going to be on the iliac crest. And you can see as the origin works its way around here, it stops. So the origin is going to be on roughly the anterior two-thirds of the iliac crest here. As the internal oblique continues its journey around to the posterior of the body, we can see its last origin point, which is on the thoracolumbar fascia. I've highlighted the thoracolumbar fascia here in green. The thoracolumbar fascia is a large, roughly diamond-shaped area of connective tissue. This area is more lightly coloured than the rest of the musculature of the lower back, which makes it easier to identify when it's not highlighted. Continuing that view of the posterior of the body, we can see our first insertion point, highlighted here in blue. This insertion point is on the inferior margins of the 10th to 12th ribs and their adjacent costal cartilages. So this rib here would be the 12th rib, this would be the 11th rib, and then this would be the 10th rib. And you can see this insertion going around to the anterior of the body. And as we move to an anterior view here, you can see that continuation of the insertion on that 10th rib coming across onto those adjacent costal cartilages. Obviously, the costal cartilages are made of cartilage, and you can see they're a lighter white coloured area comparative to the bone colour here. So the purpose of the costal cartilages are that they contribute to the elasticity of the walls of the thorax, which is obviously useful during things like breathing. As the internal oblique moves towards the midline of the body, you can see it's inserting into the linea alba, which I've highlighted here in blue. So you remember the linea alba is comprised of the aponeuroses of the internal oblique, the external oblique, and the transversus abdominis. But it's also serving as an insertion point for that internal oblique muscle. Moving back to an anterior view of the pelvis again, we can see our last insertion point highlighted here in blue either side. And this insertion point is on the pectineal line. Now the pectineal line is a visibly raised ridge on the superior ramus of the pubic bone here.
So let's take a look at the actions next. So the action of the internal oblique muscle is going to be influenced by whether both sides contract or just one side contracts in isolation. So if both sides contract together, then that's going to cause flexion of the torso forward like that. Now, if just one side contracts, in this case, let's say the right side, then that's going to cause lateral flexion. So obviously it's going to flex the torso laterally. In addition to this, flexion of just one side can also cause rotation of the torso, just like that. Now bear in mind the internal oblique and the external oblique rotate in different directions. So for example, when the right side contracts in the internal oblique, it rotates the torso to the right, whereas if the right side of the external oblique contracts, it would actually assist in rotating the torso to the left. And if you want more information about any of the other abdominal muscles, I've got videos on all of those, and I'll put links in the description box below. So take a look at that if you want to check out any of my other abdominal muscle videos. So if you've enjoyed the video or you found it helpful, you know which buttons to press. Press these buttons down there, like, subscribe, all that good stuff. Thanks again for watching, everyone. See you all next time.